You can hear me now?
Yeah.
Hey, check that you've got your water. We won't be extending beyond 8 o'clock today. See if you can get a cup of tea or coffee or whatever it is that you drink. Anything anybody wants to say before we begin? Because you've already asked. If you want to say something before we begin.
I have a lot to share actually, but
yeah, use the time.
I've been practicing this actually, like without knowing what it is and all. Like, I did one workshop like 1.5 years back. Like being in the pause and being in the moment, and between relationship and I'm right, like that. I'm working on those things.
Mm-hmm.
But struggle is consistency, maintaining that throughout, it's too much on me. Like when I give importance for relationships and their feelings, and like my questions are also related to this one only. Actually, the child in me is asking, "What are you doing for me?" Like so.
So is your concern consistency? Is that the word I heard?
Yeah, consistency. Like I do, maybe I practice that maybe some 5 or 6 times, and then I go back to that old mode, and then like that, like switching on and off, and they're not seeing the consistency and they're not experiencing it, what I'm doing. Like, so.
Have you ever seen consistency anywhere?
No.
So why are you demanding it of yourself?
I'm expecting some results out of it.
Ah.
I expect that results.
So you're doing it to get results.
Yeah.
That's the problem. All teachers do stuff to get results from their children. Unfortunately, that's an out of control area. Even if you are consistent, the effect you have on people and what people learn will be inconsistent anyway. They will take what they want to. I don't know. Does this help?
Yeah, it does actually.
One of the things to learn over time is, I don't know if there is such a thing as right, but just to figure out whether the question you're asking makes sense.
It is about it's about the other person experiencing what I am intending to, like. So when that purpose is not served, where am I lacking? Where am I?
What makes you think you are lacking?
Again, I'm experiencing that the other person is not experiencing what I want to convey,
Yeah, that's the beauty of relationships. If everybody was able to get across what they were feeling to another person, we'll certainly have no wars, but I wonder if we even have any love.
Okay.
Vishwas?
I think what I'm asking you, Manjula, is that a fair expectation of yourself?
Yeah, I do have from myself also.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah.
That because your audience is not mirroring your feelings, emotions, thoughts, ideas, you are beginning to think that there's something wrong with you.
Yes.
Please be careful. It's a very dangerous area to step into. Guilt. The next stage is guilt. And then you'll be saying things like this to yourself, oh, I'm such a lousy person. You know, nobody understands me. Nobody loves me. Don't go there. That's the design of nature, that we do not fully understand anybody or anything. Okay. Yeah? Please be a little kinder to yourself.
This is what I was being told, actually. Be self-compassionate.
I know, no.
Okay.
Yes, Kabir.
Yeah, thanks a lot, Manjula, for your question. And thanks for Vishwas, the beautiful question that you asked on consistency. Because I've been struggling on this word consistency. And I was moving towards the stage that you said, the guilt. And even today, I was thinking I will not attend this session if I will not complete my journal. And then I was asking myself, what's important for me, journal writing or this session? But I was pressing me because I didn't want to take excuse and other things, because I had a very bad, so-called very bad week, and I couldn't keep the consistency of preparing for this. But somehow I completed one journal, this journal one, because I had promised that. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I was feeling very bad about it. But this question was for me, I think. Then when you said about it, then I was asking myself that, why can't I be a little bit kind on me? And what's in the relationship? If you are able to consistently do the each other's expectation.
Yeah, I mean, the fun.
On everything. And what is it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, please, just be a... So, after all these years of being in this field of facilitation, one of the things that people are constantly asking me is, how can I ask that wonderful, perfectly right question so that my entire audience at the same time goes into this trance-like reflection? You can't. First of all, it's going to take you that many years to come to the right question. By the time you figure that out, you'll have about 5 right questions. Let's say you reach that stage where you do ask the right question and you know it.
Yeah.
Your audience, they might be in a different world. It may not work for them at all.
It's true.
So, I'm just going to give you a little story from my own book. I was asked this question this morning. And you didn't ask me, but I'm going to tell you. So how do you know you've been successful? I was asked. And I said, I've been really successful for a really long time. And what's the measurement? And my measurement was this, that I was doing a lot of corporate work at that point in time. And so I was doing corporate work and children's camps, very different. Both used outdoors adventure. And I couldn't figure out. So I went through this stage of, you know, there's only 20 people in the room. You've got this really intense thing going on. And at the end of the program, somebody asks you, how do you think you did? I say, damn, I don't know. did they learn anything? I said, I don't know. So I went through a season, as all of us go through the season, of thinking that feedback sheets are going to give you some information. So you give this really beautifully articulated sheet of paper to your audience and say, okay, give me feedback. And you go through many seasons of that and you say, this is like a feel-good thing, you know? Okay, so, and some people measure each other on the basis of this number 5. And if you are not above 4.5, then you're not a good facilitator. You know that, right? People out there, you know what I'm talking about. This really sad method of assessing vendors, as they say, on the basis of giving them a trial program or the first program, and if you don't get more than 4.5, then you're out. And, you know, if I was in the habit of using bad words, I'd use them right now. I'm just going to let that moment go pass me by for a second. I'm going to say, so I stopped depending on somebody else telling me whether I had done a good job. I just made one big assumption that they were coming to me because I was already good.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Right. Now, first of all, I don't have to feel anything. Second, I'm not going to believe what you're going to say anyway, because at the end of a process, so I went through a season of also making that last piece in the program really energized and active and laughter and joy and all that. And I got 10 out of 10. I said, wow, this is a great way of getting good feedback. Just keep them, you know, make them feel good when they're giving that feedback sheet, filling it up, and you have a winner. Okay, so that didn't work for me. So then how did I measure myself? A time came when if somebody asked me, how do you know you've done a good job? And my answer stands true today. And the answer is, destroyed a lot of other myths in my head, but that's my measurement even today. So here's the beautiful thing. I have never failed. Okay? All right. Welcome everybody to session 5 of EE to Go. I hope you're not ready to go too early. This is only the beginning of the 5th session. Today is a bit of a relaxed piece, and I'm just going to do a little, and then we're going to have this conversation. So you ready to begin? Anybody else wants to say anything before we begin? Not ask, remember, say. Okay. You know this, right? So for the next 1.5, 2 hours, whatever, as long as we're going to be together, drag yourself, climb that ladder, whatever you have to do, get above that line. And here's something that you can always do with any group and with anybody. One of the reasons I use this over and over again at the beginning of every session is a reminder that if we are below the line, we're going to use a certain language, and then we may as well not be there. So get on top of that line, and if you're not, then let's talk about the state upfront, what your below the line state is. We're not going to repair it, but just put it out there so it's, you know, for everybody to consider. So if you had a quarrel in the past 10 minutes, you don't have to talk about it, but you can just say, yes, I had a quarrel and I'm feeling really lousy. And, you know, it just creates an opportunity for us to be a little more compassionate with each other. So if there's anybody who's below the line right now, go ahead and speak up. And if you're above the line, do a little dance. Come on, guys. Yeah, I don't see everybody shaking now. There you go. Nice. Oh. Anybody know who this is?
Yeah. Passionate person who forgot himself, engrossed completely.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is what we're going to do. We're going to start today's piece with some music. And if you have a set of headphones handy, put them on. We're going to use music as our tool today. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm just going to hand this over to Che. Stop share.
Yeah.
Okay.
So we
begin first. So we're not doing the playing normal, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Close your eyes and listen. Was that enough for you to experience? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Was that enough of an experience?
Yes.
No.
Yes.
Please describe it to me. Yeah, go ahead. Sorry, Jeevan.
It was a very brief one, very like just a
piece. Okay. Within the limitations of the experience, please describe to me what you heard.
I was not focusing much on the lyrics, I was focusing
this is soulful.
On the song.
Okay.
Heard some word.
It's very soulful. The music was very soulful.
Okay.
Just felt like swinging with that music.
Okay. So that's what the music did to you. Yeah. Let's get a little technical about this now. If you were to describe that, when you describe music, how do you describe it if you were to use technical language?
We'll probably refer to the instruments used.
Sorry, say that again.
We will refer to the instruments used.
Go ahead.
Genre, I'm not too sure if that was...
That doesn't matter.
And also the level of beat.
Level of?
Beats. Beat. High.
Okay. Yes, Cynthia, go ahead. You were saying...
Oh, I'm not too sure about the instrument that was used, but I think there was a saxophone, if I'm not too wrong. And there was I'm not sure if the piano, it's the piano or the Casio. So that was used as well as, I think it started with the Casio and then it moved on to the saxophone.
Did it sound like it was balanced?
Yeah, it was.
Okay, great. Now, so there was a certain balance to the instruments, the voice, you know, the way it was. That's what I'm hearing you say. Yeah?
Yep.
Okay, now I want you to listen to another piece of music. No, it's different. Now I want you to listen to it again. Listen to it as long as you can. And think of what kind of words you... Again, we're not looking at the feeling level. We're looking at... if you were to describe it using technical words, how would you describe it, okay? Great.
Same song, different
setting? Anything but using the...
Okay. I'll do the same song.
Okay. But does it come out? Okay.
Okay, cool. You'll have to move
it. Yeah, one sec. Yeah.
The thrill is gone, baby. The thrill is gone away from me. Although I'll still live on, but so lonely.
Your sound off? Okay. All right. Was this, can you hear me?
Yeah.
Was this any different?
It was different, yes.
Yeah.
Very shrieky.
Very
high pitch. And shrieky.
Yeah, I can't hear you. Can you hear me? Yeah.
Yes. It was shrieky. High pitch.
Say that again.
It was shrieky.
Okay.
And high pitch.
High pitch.
Yeah. And didn't enjoy this piece.
Enjoy it. Tell me more. I can see
why is alarm. So tell me, you might use different.
Which was, there is an echo coming.
Yeah. Once.
Okay.
Is it better or no?
No, still
some echo.
There's still an echo.
Yeah.
Now?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think this is happening because you and Che are probably in the same room.
We are.
We were also.
So your volume coming
in
from
the same room, man.
Him also. We guessed it.
Right. Go on. So, it was intolerable. It was, you know, it's like...
Screeching.
I
came in late, so I couldn't hear the earlier song. But if I just purely go by my experience of listening to this song, I could... I'm not a fan of... English.
Don't go. See,
yeah, so no, but I'm just going to say I purely went, I closed my eyes and I quite enjoyed the piece. So I could hear the distinct divisions in the music and the voice. And I could also hear a third thing coming, you know, other than the guitar that was playing, the other percussion, I mean, whatever it was, the percussion or whatever the like a bass playing behind.
Would you listen to the music like that?
Would you
listen to it like that?
I don't know, but when I closed my eyes...
If you don't know, stop. If you don't know, we're going to give you another taste of it.
No, I don't know, but that in this moment, what I want to share is that in this moment, when I listen to it, I quite distinctly listen to it in all three zones, you know, where it was playing. And it was kind of an enjoyable, it didn't create a disturbing stir inside me.
Got it. Let's try it again.
Yeah.
Let's try it again. Okay. Mm-hmm. It'll be for a shorter time this time, but let's try it again.
Okay.
Go.
Yeah, I now kind of know if you this is a different piece. So I would say the earlier experience was of like an atonal music where I had to make an effort to actually listen to all the three things that were happening, and the enjoyment came later. Yeah, the enjoyment came earlier. Because also maybe it was very tonal. It was in the sense it was very likable, the whole composition. And I guess I've heard this earlier. So this conditioning came with it that I've heard it before. And because of that, the liking was much, much more. And so I kind of started shaking my head and kind of started grooving along with it.
Oh, that's cool. Did you see the other people in the room?
No, I didn't. I closed my eyes again.
That was interesting. People were doing this. Okay, great. Point made. We're going to play you another piece of music. And I want you to tell me how this piece is different from the one we just played, okay? And it may be a same or different piece of music, but in terms of tonal quality, as you call it. Are you ready? Okay. Anything. But not true. Yeah, I'm in it.
But
bass. Okay. You're never playing flat, okay. Except to the end. Once in a lifetime. Yes, my question. What was different?
So many variations in one this song.
Mixed flowing. Cocktail. Yeah.
Cocktail. What was the cocktail?
Mix of different, stimulating different emotions and mood.
Oh, okay.
The beginning was a very smooth and
melodious,
melodious kind of tune, and
different
then
tempos,
the
different
rap,
bass,
the which is
okay, great.
Very so, different change, emotions okay. also change.
So you'll notice that kind of sounded different. You initially you started off with, you know, there was something going on. And then suddenly we switched it and you went, ooh, right? And we had a good laugh here. And each piece of music, so I'm going to build this analogy between what we do and this whole thing about music. And if you, so just in case those of you who might be interested in music, that first piece we played is by this maestro called B.B. King. And I need to share screen. Why is my mouse not coming back here? Okay, ta-da! We're back. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
Great. So, the moment we do this, thing goes.
You just got to click back.
Right. So this is B.B. King. Brilliant musician, passed away at the age of 80-something, I think last year or a couple of years ago. yeah, this is what? This is Metallica?
Kiss.
Kiss. Okay, this is a band called Kiss. Listen to their music. That's also music for some. Then you have Dolly Parton. Queen. Our local Parsi boy born in India who went to, you know, the Bohemian Rhapsody is a movie that came out recently.
Yes.
And of course, my all-time favorite, Bob Dylan. Okay, so listen to each one of these and you'll find that they use the sounds of their instruments very differently. Now, why am I saying this? Have you, do you know what an equalizer is? Yeah, when you listen to music, there's something called an equalizer. Okay, and what we were doing was, so this is all what we call bass. The thump of the drums, the bass guitar, boom, 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 boom. That comes from this range. The screechy sounds, as you call them, come from this range. And the voice comes from this range, which we call mid-range. And depending on how you like to listen to music, you can move these sliders up and down and make the act of listening to music a pleasurable experience. I'm sure you've been on the road somewhere and you hear this car go by and the drums are going boop, 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 right? And you're outside, but it's extremely irritable, right? And it's like, it's almost like it's hitting your heart. And it can cause it can change your mood. So these sliders are really important, and they can change your mood, can change depending on how you move those sliders up and down. In the kind of work we do, so this is called an equalizer, and this is an equalizer for music, and these are kilohertz and so on and so forth. You can go into that a little later if you want, but in our world, we have an equalizer as well. And this equalizer is four pieces that are really critical for us to be able to learn to move around depending on what we want from what we want to do to the audience or how we want to create an environment for them. Okay. Briefly mentioned in almost every session, physical, intellectual, emotional, social, and environmental. Okay. Now, what does that mean? If you're doing an activity, if you raise the physical equalizer high, what does that mean? What are you doing? Give me an example of making your activity very physical.
If they have to build or construct something in an activity, that's probably physical. Or like the example you gave where they had to pull somebody, the example you had given about the girl who was hesitant, maybe that okay. was physical.
So how would I increase the physicality of an activity?
By having the level of difficulty of the strength required or the...
Okay, the, so it's strength.
Yeah,
it could be movement, so make them run around a lot. So if they have to fetch something, then make them run to fetch it. Make it extremely physical.
Yes.
Okay, you got that? So, for example, an activity which requires them to build something on the tabletop would be a very low, on a scale of 1 to 10, it would be a 1. Because they're just using their hands, they're not really moving around. On the other hand, if I take people up a mountain, and that mountain is very steep, it might be 10 for some and 5 for those who've been on mountaintops before or physically fit. So for each one, it's going to be a different number, for example. But by and large, we can change the physicality, increase and decrease the physicality of an activity by getting them to move more or do more physically. Yeah? Got it so far? So what would be a physical, a one on a physical? What kind of one or two or three? Give me an example of something that you do or have done.
Yeah, see how many different parts of the body that we use and different levels of the movement and...
Give me an activity, Kabir.
So, tangrams we did was level one.
Okay, tangram would be what?
Level one.
Level one physical.
Probably zero, no?
Yeah, it's very less.
Yeah.
Zero. Okay.
There was no physicality.
Writing work? Sitting and
Maybe like a Domino challenge or something when they have to build something from Domino on the ground.
Okay, that would be what?
One?
Monica?
Yeah.
Go on. Now,
just show your, say a metaphor for your name and show it in your one moment using your whole body.
Okay, how much?
Yeah, you can use, for example, I'll say
give
that.
Give me a number, Kabir.
Okay, number. Five? Out of 10? Yeah.
Okay. Really?
Yeah. Okay. Because
now, so here's the interesting thing. You heard my reaction, right? For you, it's a 5.
Yeah. Okay.
From my world of experience, it's a 1 or a 0.5. Okay. So I'm just going to give you the example of those kids pulling each other up. Now, here's how I could tweak it. If I put that rope through just a single loop or a metal thing on top, okay? Let's say, and I ask four people to pull up a 100 kilo person, that would probably be a 9.
Yes.
If I wanted to reduce that 9, what could I do?
You could add more pulleys or pulley systems. Add a pulley to the loop. Reduce the weight.
Use a pulley with a bearing and stuff.
Yeah.
What increase is?
the number of people pulling.
You got that? So increase the number of people pulling. And so now this is how you vary it. Okay? But if I don't have a 100 kilo person, I could choose a 50 kilo person and put a 100 kilo backpack on them and then ask them to pull up.
Yeah.
So depending on where you are and what you want to do. So physicality, the effort required. Okay?
And isn't it also dependent on...
Yes, Soumya, I can't hear you clearly.
Yeah, can you hear me now?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just asking, doesn't that also depend on the group that you're working with too?
Sure. I mean, if they're pehlwans, then I'd add 500 kilos more maybe.
Yeah. Or if you're, let's say, working with older people.
Sure.
Good.
See, so what you're now doing is going to that environmental piece, the environment we're working in. And the environment includes not just the setting, but who's my audience. You're absolutely right. So you're considering all that. But in the context of that environment, you would fool around with these slides. Okay? Great. Give me an example of intellectual. Moving the slider up and down.
The tangram activity was intellectual.
Yes.
3, 4, 3.
Okay. How would you increase it?
By getting more complicated diagrams?
No.
Other than the cat.
Okay, that's one.
By reducing
the time. You can reduce the time for doing that activity.
Okay.
By increasing the number of pieces.
And also putting more...
That's a given. Some things you want to have fixed, right?
Okay.
You can increase the number of pieces. Yes, I completely agree with you. But then that is likely to become another activity.
Okay.
Yes, tangram is 7 pieces.
If it's 7 pieces, how could you increase the intellectual slider?
Make it
even you can restrict the discussions. The members can't discuss or something like that.
Will that raise intellectual?
Yeah, because each one has to put more effort here. Yeah, change the rules. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, these are all rules, right? These are the constraints that we are putting in. Okay. Cool. You're getting the idea. Cool. How about emotional? Which actually let's just use tangrams for that. How would you slide it up, increase the emotional experience of that?
In tangram itself?
Yeah.
Blindfolding?
Sorry?
Blindfolding? Blindfolding participant?
Sorry, Monica, say that again.
Blindfolding?
Ah. Yes, absolutely. What else?
Make it an individual activity.
Wow.
You can't ask for help.
Right. And you put a rule constraint saying you can't ask for help. Okay.
Like putting a spotlight. Like doing it one by one.
Ah,
spotlight is on.
Careful with that one. Hot seating. You're calling it spotlight. I'm calling it hot seating.
Yeah. That could be that danger zone.
As a blanket thing that we do not use that method in our methodology. There's a whole world of behavioral science that uses it. Okay. we don't use it unless we have complete consent and the freedom to back off whenever they want to.
Yes.
With no judgment being made. Ideally, never hot seat. Sorry, sometimes I'll come out with, you know, some of this stuff that which is just me talking. I will never hot seat. Because it's like taking choice away from them.
Right.
Yeah. Okay. But you're absolutely right. Hot seating will increase the emotional experience.
Yes.
Okay. Another example of increasing the emotional experience in the context of tangrams would be getting one group to get the other group to build. So you have the blueprint is with team A and the tangrams are with team B and they are, you've got a barrier between them so they can't see each other. And you've got to get the blueprint guys to get these guys to build it. How many people stress out in the eye because most of your life is like that. The blueprint is somewhere and the people who are designing it is somewhere else.
Right.
Right. Okay. What about social? How would you tweak tangrams for social?
Making it collaborative.
Okay.
Make one do it based on others' instruction.
Okay. So anything that involves people really...
Ensure participation of everybody.
Okay. Yeah, well, just remember, participation from everybody is a myth.
Oh, okay.
Yes. So it's invitation.
And I'm just saying that straight away because you're going to ask me this question at different times. How do I get everybody to participate? You can't. So don't waste your time there. The whole objective is to get as many to participate as much as possible within that time frame.
Yeah.
Okay, great. So let's move on. I don't know if you're anybody familiar with this activity? Okay.
Yes.
Great. So it's I'm just putting this out there as a typical activity that almost everybody uses. It has very simple props, and I'm going to show you a lot of visuals so you get a sense of what's going on. Let's just put the whole thing out there. Oops, should have had a picture, no? Yeah? Very simple. You've got those half section pipes and you've got a marble there. And the rules are pretty tight. The marbles can't stop, they can't roll back, pipe sections can't touch each other. If you drop a marble, you go back to the start and so on and so forth. Classic, this is an activity that, you know, everybody uses and it's skilled. You mention pipes and marbles to anybody who does any of this experiential stuff and say, yeah, I know what it is. Okay, so I'm going to use that activity just to show you how it can be tweaked and you can use the equalizer to move things around. Now, just remember that pies is in the context of safety as well. So when you talk of doing this activity, you want to be sure that you're working on flat ground. You don't want rocks in the area. You don't want walls, and unless you're changing the challenge level physically and they're familiar with the territory, you want to keep it flat and straight. Okay? So physical safety is something you want to take care of. So here's what we could do. And for the activity, for this, any questions about the activity?
No, but I think I'll hold on to that question until you finish. Yeah, I'm just wondering on what basis will the equalizer, you know, the physical, intellectual or emotional be changed? Is the outcome that we're looking for is participation, or is the outcome, I mean, on what basis are we going to change the...
On basis of what you want to get out of it. You answered your question.
Okay.
Depending on what you want. Example, you've got a class that you've been sitting and thinking and writing and drawing or whatever. You've been physically very still. And you want to throw an activity at them. You might want to tweak the physical piece. Okay? If you notice that there's a class, you've got an audience that is having some desperate issues around conversations. They're not able to have a conversation. They don't know how to deal with conflict. Which one would you tweak?
Social, I guess. I think a bit of social and emotional.
Ah, so here's the thing. You tweak one, it's bound to affect at least one other.
Right.
And that's where you got to play with it. That if you want social interaction and you want conflict, then, yeah, okay. So here's some of my angst and anger coming out. You know these elimination games that people play on birthday parties? Musical chairs. Oh, man. Do I need to explain? Classic example of people not knowing what they're doing. My son's birthday party, I call a whole bunch of kids, and just by chance, he happens to be the first one to be out of the game. Can you imagine what it does to him? We don't even think about it. And our glib response to a kid coming and crying to you and saying, my birthday, I got eliminated first, is, are hota hai yaar. Don't worry, next one we'll see that you win. Or don't worry, you and the winner will get the same prize. What message are we sending through all that? Classic examples of social faux pas, of errors that we make in our conduct as adults. Because I'll tell you what, we picked it up from some adult in our life. They didn't know what they were doing. All you people out here, you can't claim innocence anymore. You understand that, right? You play those games and I figure it out. I'm going to have some questions, hard questions for you. And you better have a good reason. So unless you have a scenario, a group that is in conflict but not willing to look at it, you may not, so if you want them to look at that, then you would use something like an activity which has nothing at that point in time, during that play, it has nothing to do with real life, but the conflict emerges and that activity is then used as a mean to bring it back to real life conversations about conflict in the scenario that they are in. Are you seeing why we use activities? Okay, so we're going to dive a little.
Sir, sorry, I didn't get your last point. When we use activities and conflict.
Yeah, so I would use that activity when they're at play, they're at play. But the same things that normally happen emerge, and I use that to have a conversation about conflict. I begin with a conversation about conflict emerging in the context of the activity. Then I move it to a question that makes the connection between conflict in the activity and conflict in real life. And that's how we use the activity, that there is no great purpose in creating conflict through the activity unless we bring it back to what is actually happening with them. Then we are building a context and we are building the connections.
Sure.
So I say, look, you know what happened here? Where else does it happen? They say, yeah, you know what happens every day? Really? You play pipes and marbles every day? No. It happens with everything else. Oh, great. Do you want it to happen that way? What are some alternate ways of looking at how you deal with it? And that's how those connections are made. So the activity is always, usually, only a means to an end. You always want to bring it back to what's real. Okay?
Yeah.
Great. So here's how we tweak it. Now, this is in the context of that one activity, okay? Pipes and marbles. Using only one hand. Blindfolding. So each time we do this, now just remember, while we are trying to increase physical challenge here, tell me if any of the others are being affected, okay? Using only one hand?
Emotional.
Correct. Frustration building up and emotional, it might raise the emotional peak. Blindfolding?
Emotional.
Asking somebody to stay mute?
Social and emotional.
Right. Using water instead of marbles?
Intellectual.
Also physical?
Yeah. Also physical?
Yeah.
What about setting expectations?
Intellectual.
Physical,
emotional.
Intellectual.
Physical, emotional.
Actually, something like that will raise almost all of them.
Almost all.
Yeah.
Yeah? So emotional, social as well. You're not doing this, man. Why are you always dropping the marble? Yeah. You got trouble.
Pressure.
Yep. Tying them in pairs to limit movement.
Physical, emotional, social, intellectual.
Yeah. Okay, good. You guys are smart. You're getting the hang of it. Okay, have a look at the others. So, you know, classic example of when I landed up for a corporate program and my bags went in the other direction. So all my props went away, but marbles are something you can buy in any shop almost. And I didn't have the pipes, so we used paper. It changes the challenge level as well, just remember that. So just stuff like that. Okay. You understood that piece? Any questions? No? Good. Let's look at intellectual. So a classic way to increase intellectual challenge is to ask them to present a plan before they deliver. An execution plan. And it might work and it might not work, and that's okay. But you're at least getting them to think about it before. So also building a metaphor, which means that the props are similar to something. And I'll talk about it a little as we...
You're not able to use.
Chetan, you're there? Che, sorry. Che, you have lost Vishwas.
I'm here jumping.
Oh, ta-da! I've got a new name. Okay, so what about that screen?
I just forgot that.
We moved office, so I'm not working from home. So we're still trying to figure life out. Okay, where are we? You want to turn that monitor?
But this is connected to this.
Oh, okay.
So,
share from my. Okay. Hmm. Hi, Jalashima. Tika. Yeah, are you hungry?
Give me a second, guys. Something go. Can you still see me?
Yes.
Okay. So you're still there. Okay, so while that thing is still loading, how would you increase? So we've done physical, we've done intellectual, emotional. How would you increase the emotional challenge?
They're not supposed to speak.
You're supposed to speak. Oh, you mean they're not supposed to speak? Okay.
Yeah.
For this activity, I'm not able to differentiate between emotional and social.
Okay. So, a clear differentiation, let me help you out with that one. A social tweak would be anything that gets them to either relate more or relate less. So I'll give you an example. If I said that each one is supposed to deliver a certain number of products by yourselves in the next 5 minutes.
Okay.
I'm taking away social. Okay. And it's impossible to deliver that under the conditions. And I give only 5 minutes because it takes them that much time to arrive at that place where they say, my God, without somebody else, I can do nothing. So that emotional piece goes up during those 5 minutes. The intellectual piece goes up because they're thinking things through, trying to find ways of being able to do it. But unless I hold one pipe like this and one pipe like that, and then I do this, and then I do this. It gets quite crazy. It gets really hard. So the physical goes up, social drops, everything else goes up. You get that?
Right.
Okay. Right. Okay, that's just an example of how we are. Are you seeing the presentation?
No.
Okay, here we go. Are you seeing it now?
No.
Oh.
Yeah. Right.
So here your emotional was up, right?
Yeah, here I am, right? My emotional state going, and then I have to use a dampener to figure out my emotional.
And you use the social.
Yeah, so I can reach out to the group and reduce my emotional state, bring it down by sharing with the group saying, hey, you know what? I don't own the internet. Oops, gone. Are you there? You're still there.
Yeah, your voice is breaking a lot. Should we switch off our videos?
No, your voice is breaking.
It's a problem with the connection we are at.
Yeah, I think it might help for all of us to switch off video. And
maybe we can switch it off.
Okay. Shall I continue though?
Yeah, continue.
I think this is much better.
Yeah, because you can see me and I can't see you. It's always safer. You got that. Okay. Are you seeing my screen?
Yes.
Okay, so. We've done this. Increased intellectual, we've done. Okay, we've talked about that. We've talked about this. Okay, here are examples of increased social challenge.
Breaking now also.
Okay, look at the screen and read it.
Your voice is breaking.
Here are examples of increase in the setting. You change the setting. Is my voice still breaking?
No, now it's okay.
It's better.
Ah, my health is improved. Okay.
Your video is lagging, that's all. I think your voice is fine.
There's a noise in the background.
Okay. So that's the activity. I'm going to show you some visuals. Okay, this is an example. There was an oil, an organization that was in the oil business. And the metaphor was, okay, so you have to transport oil from the rig in the, can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay. And the metaphor was you have to transport oil from the rig in sea to the processing plant on shore, and you don't want to waste oil. How are you going to do it? And they struggled so much. So I gave them one full bucket of water at one end, and I said, I want that bucket of water at the other end. At the end of 45 minutes to an hour, what they had was about a mug full. And it wasn't because they weren't trying hard. It's just that what that activity brought out for them was how diligent they have to be, you know, interdependence, how critical that is, how critical talking to each other is, and how critical individual performance is. So a team is a dream. It's an idea. It doesn't exist. We're constantly trying to get to that place of being a team through things like this. So one full bucket, and that's how much they got at the end of it. So here's my question. If you did this activity with children, what concepts could you teach them?
Teamwork.
Gravity.
Not behavioral.
Okay.
You know, schools want to deliver content, right? Now here's an opportunity. What content can you deliver through this?
Gravity.
Huh?
Statistics.
Gravity.
Gravity. Okay. What else?
Logistics.
Speed.
Balance.
Logistics. Balance. Why would children need to? There is logistics part of any curriculum? Which book is it in?
To learn balance, to understand where to hold. So it's the balancing of the pipes.
Okay. We can bring out how collaboration is much better than competition.
That is all behavioral stuff.
Angles and speed.
Here's the thing, right? I'm moving it from activity to what concept can you teach? What concepts come alive in a thing like this?
I think
angle.
What's that?
Balance.
Principle. And you can't just say angle. Look, are you all graduates?
If the angle is small, we can control the speed. If the angle is more, the speed will be.
Why chapter from that math book? What is the concept from that book that we mindlessly go into a classroom and teach children, but it comes alive real life here?
That I think one of Newton's laws that something. That till something is not stopped, it keeps flowing. If the motion is always there. I don't remember whether the first or the second.
Which school did you go?
E equal to MC.
I don't care. I went to Mount Carmel Convent School.
Okay, so this is
E equal to MC.
Here in this room, please understand this. This is really important. This is why we're here.
Yeah.
That the way we've been taught, and this is what you've learned. Hey, me too, okay? It doesn't excuse me. So here's, this question I thought was brilliant when I was looking at it. I said, yeah, you know what? Here I am talking about all this nonsense. But the truth is that if you're going to go walk into a classroom, which principle can you share? And here's the thing. You can teach, you know, there's this principle about water finding its own level.
Displacement.
Osmosis.
Water finding its own level. That's one. Second, you called it gravity. I'm saying the principle of a slope, ascent and descent. What happens when you increase the angle of ascent or the angle of descent? That principle can be taught through this.
Velocity.
Velocity. Absolutely.
And one more thing. Yep. Conservation of energy, because here gravitational potential energy is there, and when the marble or something is moving, because the energy is being transformed from one place to another, so there is a potential energy due to height and it is being transferred to the kinetic energy.
There you go. Newton's law. An object tends to stay in the same place unless forced upon by another object or by a force. Okay, great. You get this? And I'm asking you to say all these activities that exist out there are by and large used mostly for this whole behavioral thing, this fuzzy behavioral thing called leadership, team building, decision making. You know what I'm talking about, right?
Yeah.
Everybody wants this fuzzy stuff. If you ask me of all the corporate training that I've done, have I ever been successful? I've been 100% successful. In what? In being able to deliver a fantastic program. If you ask me what's my ROI, then God save you. You're going in for a huge conversation with me on that. You see, the point I'm making is this. People are investing crores of rupees in human development in this behavioral field. The truth is you cannot measure return on investment. And the reason is that you don't know when that person is going to change. And we're going to jump into your questions very shortly. And the point I'm trying to make here is that many of you are saying, "Are I did this and nothing happened. That person didn't even bat an eyelid." Of course they're not. Problem. And then you start taking it upon yourself. I can't change the world. Of course you can't. You can't change a damn thing. You can change it only when you stop wanting it. When you can step out of that place and say, I'm going to do my thing, and if something happens, great. If nothing happens, great. Sorry, I told you a lot of this stuff slips into this thing called philosophy. Can't help it, but we'll talk about it. Okay. So here's
I should learn to correct kara wo link ready rakho yeah I need extra bucket ha
main wahan pe bhi chalega
acha acha main abhi maine
okay
you take this no problem don't move make a
problem no problem
I need the third jar
yeah le
Hugely engaging. Is everybody engaged? They better be.
Yeah.
You know? And just now imagine this. If I had used an egg, what is doing to your brain? oh my God. And then I make it even worse. I say, you know what? That's your child. Oh my God. How can I let my child drop? Oh, that's children. And you're saving them from some catastrophe. So here's where that whole thing begins to move into a different arena altogether. Play with it. So here's an example of how you see. Can you see what's going on here? She's on a 10 millimeter wire. And all those people with their hands out is preventing that the physical safety piece. I can reduce that challenge by giving that bamboo stick, but then it becomes an individual challenge of somebody going across from one pillar to another. Individual. I don't care about anybody else. So as long as somebody is there to hold me, I'm fine. But if I want to change that and make it really social. So on the social scale, this would be really low. Like one. Yeah? On the physical, giving her that bamboo stick is like two. Okay? No intellectual, no brains needed to walk across that wire. No problem solving, no plan, no nothing. You just step onto it, use that bamboo and walk across. Emotional, no big deal, maybe a two. So this is really low. And here's what you can do. The same activity. So the objective is for the whole group to cross from one pillar to another. Here's an example of how it plays out. Take away the bamboo. They can't touch anybody except anybody who's on the wire. People down there can't offer them support. They can't seek support. And the only people alive are the ones at either end. And you change the whole configuration of that experience. Okay? So this is, anybody familiar with this? So that ball, it's a ring and it's got strings and they have to stay away and they have to deliver that ball onto this pipe. Okay? Simple enough. How do you change that experience? Now, how many people involved here? Eight. If you have a large group, this is what you can do. So now you can always increase the challenge level by blindfolding some players. So now they have to look after each other. So you change that social piece, you change the emotional piece, you change the physical piece, everything changes. Okay, so you see that intensity of engagement. Okay, great. So, last little piece before we move on. I'm going to run you through this because we're already late. Here's a list of what people said. I said, the question was, how will you create a safe environment? And this is a list of things that they said they would do. Okay, so we're going to run through this. You have it to look at later. That's a lot, right? There's more. Okay, so the expectation is not that you will look at it now. I don't want to go through it. You do it in your own time, see which is valid for you. If there's something that I'd love to know, if there's something that you come up with that's true for you, that may not be in the list, okay? Then somebody asked me, he said, ha, you're doing all this, but what do you do? So here's my take on it. And I had to really think it through. I cannot make somebody else safe if I'm feeling potentially unsafe and unprepared. Okay, so this is a list of stuff that I do. You can have a look at it later. Okay?
Vishwas, I just have a quick question. Why, just curious to know why, what new things am I going to do is very important. Because sometimes I get so stressed about that when I'm designing stuff for my classes, and I'm just trying to understand.
Years ago, and I'm talking of years ago, I said to myself, my learning style is the accommodator style at that point in time. And I didn't read much. And when I found that reading was important, I picked up a book and I found that I couldn't go through too much. But what I did was got access to books that I just ran one activity. And I said, I'm going to run this during the next program that I do. And one activity at a time. And today, I know thousands. One activity each session, and you'd be amazed at what happens to your perspective about what activity is. So always a new activity. This whole online thing, I can't tell you how much fun we are having because, damn it, each session we're trying to do something new, you know? Yeah. And that's the promise we make to ourselves. So that's an important piece. Yeah?
Thanks.
Okay. Ah, ready? Got your props? Yeah? Okay.
What props?
And you know what? Here's my question. We can either do the activity or we can... I do not want to extend it beyond 8 o'clock today. We've got half an hour. This can be done anytime in the next session as well. I would much prefer addressing the questions that have been raised because I think they're important.
Yes.
Are you okay with that?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Cool. So I'm going to start with I'll read out the questions and then okay.
You want to share screen?
No. Probably not. You know what? I'd like to. Yeah, I'll read the question and I'll just talk from there.
Okay, good.
Okay, question number one. How do I move through the experiential learning cycle when it's not my style? Okay. And then my question was, whose style are you talking about? And of course, the answer was, it's about me and my students. Sorry. You can't be that all-encompassing. It's always about you and your students, but it's about you first. If you don't change your style, your students are not going to be invited to change their style because you're not doing it. So just remember.
Can't hear.
Can't hear? Now?
I can hear.
So we can't.
We can hear you.
We can hear.
We can hear.
I think it's breaking in
between. Okay.
I'll go out and lobby.
How is it now?
It's fine.
Okay. So what I'm going to try and do is to share with you. Where is that? It's that Q&A. Maybe I need to close this. Okay, doesn't matter. I'm just going to answer them. The thing is this. I will share with you a slide that tells you what the opposite behaviors are. And just remember that in my own life, I used to be a huge accommodator. That was my learning style, which means action and feeling, and everything was driven by how I felt about it and whether it was exciting to do or not. And when somebody asked me that important question that I couldn't answer, I suddenly switched from, over the years, I've moved from there to moving to becoming a diverger and then to an assimilator. So you can change your style. And I think the point here is that you have to want to do it. That's really critical. Does that answer your question? So you first, when you can do that, then you're in a better position to use the four different styles of the Kolb's learning cycle. And when you can make your classroom more exciting, then you will find that other people will also, your students will also start learning. And just remember one thing, don't start expecting things to change overnight. Look at how long it has taken us to come to where we are. I think it's fair to give our students that time as well. Yes?
Yes.
Okay. Two, how do I use the experiential education in my personal relationships? I have to pause and be in the moment. Elaborate with an example. I've been using it constantly today. What I wanted to do is not working out. The screen's showing something quite different and I don't get it. And Che is sitting there trying to figure it out, and inside me I'm saying, hey, breathe. It's okay. What's the worst that can happen? I can still see you I can still talk to you. And I start looking, and that pause allows me to look at what works, not what doesn't work. When I can move my attention to that, then it changes the way I see and what I feel. So I can, you remember, we talked about the sliders. The sliders, if we can change an experience for our audience by moving, by doing things to move the sliders up and down, I'm guessing we can do it for ourselves as well. And most of the time when this question is asked, how do I affect my own personal relationships? Rule number one, remember that? And sometimes if you're at home, do it. While when you find yourself getting agitated, start breathing. Something, you know why breathing? Any idea?
It gives oxygen to our brain.
Sure.
Helps us calm down.
Oxygen, doesn't it get it all the time anyway?
Extra dose.
Huh?
Some more extra dose.
No. Usually, think of this. The times that you have that trouble is when you are switching, you hear something or that person has said something that gets you to move to what we call the fight or flight mode. Right? You either want to oppose or you want to run away.
Yeah.
Right? Now, in fighting and flight, the blood rushes away from the brain to the extremities to take action. And that what that pause and the breathing essentially does is to bring it back to the brain. Have you ever felt intensely angry? Raise your hand if you ever have. Do you remember anything? Unlikely.
Just the anger.
Yeah, unlikely. You know what?
Yeah, later on, you just forget what happened.
Tears in the eyes. Your head gets hot. You can't tell distance very well. You can't, your language leaks out. Yeah? Why? Because the blood's gone. And all you got to do at that point in time is tell that person, hey, hold on. And they'll wonder what you're doing. But you know what? That in itself has the ability to change the mood.
Okay.
My son, who's missing right now, will vouch for you and tell you that I have done it many, many times. Okay. Next question. ITI principles, personality affects learning. Whose are we talking about? We're talking about the students, the learners' personality. And when we talk about personality, all these instruments, they're often called personality tests. So personality is not character. A personality is what are the leanings? What are your emotional leanings? What are your intellectual leanings? That's what we're talking about there. Does that answer your question? Next one. Movement enhances learning. Yeah, great. Is it age related? Anybody, everybody. The choice we made today was to go intellectual rather than partly physical because of the choices we had at that point in time. Okay, we will do the activity, but we will do it a little later. If I don't address these questions, what we're going to do later is going to, we're going to miss out on stuff. I've got 20 minutes left. I'm mindful of it. Just know that. Examples of invitational theory in practice, especially during short training sessions. Oh, I love that question. Invitational education is about our attitude towards anything. It's not about the other person. When you walk into a room, they have to feel like, wow, today's going to be a great day. The way you walk in, the spirit that you bring into that room, the smile, the ease, and to be able to do that, you have to be easy with yourself first. You can't do that if you're stressed out and nervous. Here's a story. I was going through this was some years ago, and I was going through an emotional upheaval. I was on my way driving to a program, and I was a mess emotionally. And I had to get into a program, and I stopped the car on the way. It was a 3-hour drive, kind of stopped the car. And I called up a friend and I said, look, you know what? I'm a mess. Talk me through it. And I sobbed and I wept and I screamed and I shouted. I was alone in the car, so it didn't matter. It was in the wilderness. And when it was done, I reached the site. I was still a mess, but not so much. And I told the group, I said, hey, you know what? I'm not feeling too good. I need a couple of hours. My colleagues will help you run through the first couple of hours, but here's the objective. I will be back by 11 o'clock. And I took those 2 hours, I got into my frame. I was able to see my world view and, you know, kind of put whatever I was dealing with to a side. And when I entered, and we had a great program. If I had walked in with that emotional state, in that emotional state, it would have been a mess for everybody. And we've got to remember that we affect people intensely by our presence. They know that you are there for them. If we are not in the right place, whatever that means to you, they're not going to be in the right place. And that invitation must have intentionality. If I'm an emotional mess, how can I be intentional with my group? Does that make sense? Yeah, so just remember, take time off before you walk into that space. Even if you're a daily teacher, classroom teacher, when you reach school, spend 10 minutes by yourself. Ask yourself this question, why am I doing what I'm doing? You may not always have a good answer, but ask yourself that question. And the days you have a great answer, you'll walk in and you will blow them apart just by your presence. And they will, you see, here's the beauty. They will understand everything even though you didn't say anything. And on the days that you're a mess, you can say as many intellectual things as beautifully as you think you thought you said them, and they may not understand a word. Because their attention is taken away by your presence. We are animals first. We sense, we respond. The educator's sense of being can be a huge threat to its audience. When you are upset, they know it. They may not say it. When you're angry, they will be angry, and very often they will mimic your own emotion. When you are upset, they will go silent. When you're joyful, they will go noisy. That's fine. Okay. I think this, a lot of people have asked me this question on the invitational education piece, and I want you to remember this. Who you are is going to affect what is going to happen. Don't take yourself lightly. And this is true with every relationship. You know, a lot of young people, they want something from their parents. When they want that too badly, I can assure you, you smell it as a parent. Avni, you know what I'm talking about. Okay? But if you go out there and say, hey, you know what? If they say no, that's fine. That no is for today. It's not for a lifetime. Then you go in with the spirit and the freedom. And they sense it and they say, yaar, panga lene mein kuch hone wala hai nahi. So don't go in with panga. Anytime you walk into a room to take panga, Monica, do you know that word? Cool, thank you. When you, they smell it. Watch any Bollywood movie. Okay? And if you want to watch a movie where, watch any James Bond movie and you'll know that he doesn't take panga. He's just so confident and self-assured and everything. That he just walks into the room and everything changes. So anytime you walk into any room, please be aware of what mood you're in because you're going to affect the other person. Okay. How does invitational education play out when children don't submit homework or respond? Whose problem is that? Whose problem is homework and responsiveness? Is it your student's problem or your problem?
Sir.
Huh?
Sir problem.
Simple. Go out there, walk into that room with great expectations of yourself, not from them. Now you understand why I've never failed. Even if I got 0 out of 5, I have never failed. Simple. I go out there and I have a jolly good time, as the British say. Does that answer your question? And you know what? You keep that and you stay intentional about it. They will come around, but don't expect them to come around on that day. Okay? I give you a chocolate and I want you to say thank you. Why should you say thank you? Why would you say thank you if you didn't like the chocolate? No? Maybe you should give a chocolate and then 2 days later check in and say, hey, did you enjoy that chocolate? But we want everything. We want to see change in the classroom, in the next test, in the next exam. Hey, we are doing this course. I have no idea which parts of your head and heart will move around. But I'll show you this. When they do, and they will, you will write back and say, hey, you know what? That thing you said, now I get it. I've bumped into people at Tel Aviv airport. Tel Aviv, anybody know where Tel Aviv is? Okay, Israel. Okay, I was doing some Play for Peace work there. Suddenly at the airport, I hear my voice, somebody screaming, hey, Vishwa, hi, how are you? This guy comes towards me and I said, hey, hi, how are you? Great, what are you doing? He said, you don't even remember me, do you? I said, I remember the face. He said, you did a corporate training program for us 10 years ago. I said, great. See, got you here, right? And he says, I said, what do you remember? He said, we had a great time. We talked about a lot of stuff. I haven't figured it out yet, but it was one of those moments that I just loved in my life. And he wasn't able to tell me what he learned, but damn it, he remembered it. And I don't know when some of what we talked about is going to come alive for him. So I have never failed. Okay. So maintain optimism. Okay. They will change. Your own children and not your children. Oh God, does that sound familiar or what?
Khalil Gibran.
Sorry?
Khalil Gibran.
Right. So go out there. You are the archer. Just go blow the hell out of those arrows. Just do your job. Stop worrying about somebody else. And the better you get at what you do, the better they will get. Okay. There is no such thing as constructive feedback. Sorry. That's me talking, okay? But you can go to a book if you want to learn about constructive feedback. Feedback is not about change. So the problem with the word feedback is people use it as a tool. That does not fit right with me. If you are feeding back something, don't feed back what you think should be right. Feed back what you saw, what you heard at the observation level, not from a judgmental level, not from an expectation level. How do you catch, one of the questions was, how do you catch, how do you make it in, you know, immediate? So in during activities, okay, here's, you know, when we did the tangram exercise, I was in one of those rooms. And what was the condition? You can't show it, right? And they knew it, and they knew I was there, and they showed it, and they even said, yeah, but it doesn't matter. Okay? What would instant feedback look like? It sounds like that, because they knew it, and they chose to do it, and the only thing as a facilitator I could ask is, what did you just do? What will you say?
It's okay.
Huh?
It's okay.
No, what did you just do? Answer my question.
We showed
the rules.
Huh?
Broke the rules.
Broke the rules.
Oh, really? Oh, which rule did you break? You see, the problem, you've already gone judgmental on yourselves. I'm asking you for an observation. What did you do? I didn't say what did it mean. What did you do?
I showed the.
We showed the
how to do it.
Okay.
How to do.
Showed okay. Another way of doing it.
And is that okay?
Yes.
Is that okay?
Yes.
Okay.
It is okay.
That's fine. And I will leave it at that. I know what you're expecting me to say. No, it was not okay. Yeah? Okay. I'm going to take this further. What did we agree upon?
Not to show.
Not to show.
Okay. And what did you do?
We showed it.
We showed. We didn't. Yeah.
Right. What would you now like to do?
We like to proceed without seeing the image.
We would like to do what we agreed on.
Yeah.
Okay, cool. Ready to continue?
Yeah.
I'm not passing judgment. I don't want to sit in judgment. I just, that is immediate feedback. Get it? I'm not going to say, you broke a rule. Hey, not my job. I'm just going to find out whether you are aware of what you did. And if you are not, I'm just going to move on with it. It lots of times when they know it and they say exactly what Madhu said. Yeah, we want to break the rule. Okay, cool. Then you finish the activity in like 3.5 seconds. And then I say, was that challenging enough? And you probably say no. And I say, do you want it to be challenging? Probably. Okay, so what will you do this time? And I'm not going to go anywhere near that judgmental place of saying it's good to follow the rules. Are you getting this? Okay. So, next question. You said you wanted more stories and experiences. You know what? I can tell you stories till the cows come home. And they're almost coming home right now. But this is how it plays out. Every room has at least one of those rebellious characters. And they're just being who they are. They're just challenging your status quo. And that's okay. And we have to see that and let it be. All children, we're designed to challenge our environment. Every one of these questions had, you know, that thing about how do I get them to perform well? Please go and talk to teachers and your parents whether you performed well.
Vishwas, can I ask a question here?
Yeah.
So you said each class will have that rebel student who will challenge the status quo. This is my personal experience. So what happens is there are also other students who are eager to participate in the class, who are eager to learn.
Yeah.
And if we just focus too much or just ignore that person, that whole class is lost.
Yeah.
So
is there a question?
Yeah. So the question is, like, we have to at some point of time enforce some guidelines, right? Or we losing the whole class. Like, I'm talking from sessions that I've seen
happen. Don't make mind about that. You don't have to impose anything, and you don't have to. What do you know about that person?
So we do develop some understanding of the person. We have had chats outside the classroom.
Who is we?
Sorry?
Who is we?
I.
Thank you.
So I do have an understanding. I have been I have taken sessions on a regular basis. So I know that person.
Jeevan, stop. Start challenging your own intelligence about that. I don't think we know anything. We start working from our conditioning. We don't know, which is why I asked you that question. Do you know that person's story? Most times we don't. And the reason I ask this question is the moment so here's the solution. The solution is curiosity and discovery. If you can get yourself to be curious about it and reach out to that person and find a way of doing it and find out what is their story, you might find the reason for why they are the way they are. And just that act of reaching out to them can often be the game changer. The problem is, we operate from our conditioning and then we say that, oh, but for the greater good. You know, all those war movies on Netflix and everything is a conspiracy, right? For the greater good, let's destroy only 1 million people. For the greater good, let's have Avengers. What's his name?
Thanos.
For the greater good. And your answer is for that greater good. And I'm saying, please be careful about that greater good because there is no such thing. Sorry, Jeevan. Is that okay? Play with it.
Get your point.
Try it. Invest that curiosity and see what happens. I mean, these are just, I'm just telling you this from my own story. Okay? Great. Ah. My team has been taking advantage of me being an understanding person. How do you know you are understanding? Question number one. Two, how much do you know about your people? What drives them? Let's make an assumption you do. What image did you build about them? Is it possible that in being in a leadership position is linked to exactly the scenario that you've described? And not just in, you see, as parents, we are in leadership position. Not different from working with your child. You want to help, don't want help. You want to solve their problem, but they don't need your solution. You want to reach out, but they're pushing you away. And sometimes, okay, Jeevan, here's something that you'd like. We just have to redefine boundaries. So you say it once, you say it twice, you say it three times, and then you begin to make a connection in your conversation with them that, hey, you know what? This is linked to this. If you can't do that, then this is the boundary that's going to come up. If you can't respect time, what do you think it does to me? And get them also to probably show them what their behavior is doing, not just to you, but the world around. Remember, anything to do with people is a long-term investment. There's nothing that you can achieve immediately except in the book 1984. If you've read it, George Orwell, really see the movie. Human being mass produced and being indoctrinated, where robotics is taking over. That's the scenario in which you can program people to do what you want them to do. Anybody who bleeds will give you a problem. Does that answer your question?
Which was what if you kind of, where you said what it not only does to you, but it kind of does, you know, it how it affects all of them. What if, again, offended and, you know, how would you proceed?
So what if they get offended? What are they going to be offended by?
Maybe I think the best way is to kind of get it out of them and see how they perceive the situation rather than us telling and how it is affecting.
You're absolutely right. And just remember, you can't get it out of them.
Yeah.
Okay. You have to create an environment in which they feel like getting it out. Mm-hmm. So it begins with you. It begins with us as educators, leaders, parents, whoever we are.
Okay.
Yeah,
I'm reminded of
this is time. Don't expect results tomorrow. No. For God's sake, you will be disappointed. But there's when the magic happens, you will know it. Well, technically, I am done. All questions are over. It's 8:06. I did really well. Those who wish to leave may leave. Those who wish to ask more questions, you can hang in there. I will hang in with you.
So, Vishwas, I will ask you a question building upon our last discussion. Also, this point that you're sharing. This is a real-life situation. This happened 5 years back. It's my story.
I just love the way you guys talk about real life. Okay, keep going.
Yeah, so I had just become like started working as a facilitator in the government ITI.
Okay, you have four lines to tell me the story.
Yeah, yeah. So I just started working as a facilitator, and it was a government ITI where students always came late. It was a habit, so I had to enforce some guidelines in. Even not even accepting them inside the classroom after some point of time to weed out that habit because they were being trained for a job. So they had to get that habit inside. So there was some enforcement needed.
Why? Where? Why? What assumptions have you made, Jeevan?
It's not an assumption.
What that, assumptions
that have you ITI made? Had a habit.
No. What I'm hearing is this. You have a behavior and Jeevan comes in and sets something up to change that. Yes, no, maybe.
No, I didn't set it. I didn't set it. So first day we had a discussion in the classroom and we arrived at that guideline.
Okay.
And then we followed that guideline. So I didn't set it. So I asked them like, yeah. Okay.
Go ahead.
Sorry?
I'm hearing there was agreement.
Yeah. There was just a discussion with the students, asking them to have this class in a successful manner. What should we do? So we arrived at some guidelines. And then I made sure those guidelines were followed. Like, and the context was this, that they were used to a habit and they had to be trained to go to a job. Part of employability skills and all that. So, but I had to enforce that guidelines, and because the context was very different. So, just wanted to share that.
I know, and I'm guessing they didn't learn much.
No, it worked. It actually worked. Okay, most of them. So people, the first.
So they came in time.
Coming, say 15 minutes late, 20 minutes. Yeah, they
came in time.
They started coming on time.
Oh, brilliant. Do you know what happened afterwards?
So my class, they came on time. And the hope is that my class was for 1 year.
Sorry. Did they come in time to other classes?
No, that I am not aware of. But I don't know.
Okay. So it sounds like a happy story. What's the problem?
No, not a problem. Like what I mean to say is when you say that, when you talk about the boundaries and some amount of force, maybe force is not the right word, but some amount of consequences is needed based on the context. So it was a young group, very young group. And
did you build a context?
Context, yeah, as I said, we had a discussion.
What happened? What happened when somebody came late?
So we had the system, Vishwa. So as I said, it was 4 or 5 years back. So maybe now I would have done it differently. I was new then.
I know.
So the
I'm saying yeah. You can. So here's what you can do, and you may have done it. You may not have done it. But if you say that coming to class is, let's just make some assumptions. Here's the scenario. You've got a job. Your job is to be at so-and-so class at so-and-so time. Okay? And you transfer, essentially what you could do is transfer responsibility to them. And sometimes you've got to go through that dip before learning really begins. And that dip might include, story? I was teaching in a school. They used really bad language with some teachers. Not part of my story. So I said, I'm not going to walk into a classroom that uses such language for a teacher. I didn't know anything about any of this, okay? This is 30 years ago, 30, 35 years ago. I said, I'm not going in. They also said, okay, we are not coming. I said, great. Now, this was the 12th grade first term. They're sitting for their exams. Everything becomes critical. They made that choice. All the other teachers also said, no, they're not acceptable. We are not going to go to class. Okay? We didn't have classes for one whole month. Can you believe it? 12th grade? Anywhere else, they would have said, okay, stop, put your ego aside and go into class. Yeah, these guys have to pass. And the deal was this. The issue is not just language. That was just an expression of disrespect. And disrespect was being shown in many different ways, not just to the teachers, but also to the system, to the method, to processes, to other children, so on and so forth. And we said, here's our opportunity to use this as a learning, you know, and say, look, show me. So we have, for a whole month, conversations went on as to how disrespect was being shown. So what I'm saying is that there was a dip, yes. But damn it, what we achieved at the end of it was remarkable, because something intrinsically changed for them through that 1 month of not going to class. And it was more than worth it. And the reason I tell you this is that when you can make decisions like that, no, something huge happens to your audience. Not just to your audience, but between you and your audience. Yeah? Okay. Are we done? Next section is going to be a big one. It's on building community. So we'll be doing stuff around group development, looking at how groups develop, some theoretical models on that, and how you could make it an interactive process, and how to get better at understanding how your groups function or where your group is at. Okay? Anything you want to say or ask as closure about today?
I had a question that I had posted, and I think I already have an answer after listening to some of the answers and the space that we you described today. If there is anything else, I will write to you on that question again.
Please.
Yes, I will tangle to that. I also posed the question where I had no clarification, but I think through the stories and through all the readings that I've done, I got a very clear picture. So if I will have any doubts, I'm going to write it to you. Thank you.
Please do. Okay. Sleep well, eat well, wash your hands, drink a lot of water. See you next week. I don't know if I have any journaling. So I am going to ask you for a mid-course review. You know, they call it feedback. But I just want to know. I think my interest is in finding out. I feel good. Okay? So don't focus on me at all on the feedback. I'll throw some questions at you. And just to get an understanding of whether there were things that you got, that you've taken away, that you've practiced. So just some simple questions around that. Yeah? those of you who journal will journal, those of you who don't want, there's a whole lot of people in between who are saying, should I not? And I hope you have fun trying to figure out whether you should or not, but I'm there for you.
You already got more than two tingles every time.
Plus, I think instant feedback would be this.
Okay. Cool.
Cool.
All right.
Cool.
Sleep well.
Thank you. Bye.
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 Thank bye, you, everyone.
Bye. Good night. Thank you.
Bye. Bye. Thank you.
Bye. Bye.
Oh.